Roundtable Live for August 12, 2016. My name is Barrett, joined by Rockley Smile Mathis Games and our two returning guests, Michael A.L. Fox and Last Gray Wolf. Hello.
Hey. Hello.
Welcome, folks. Welcome back, Mathis. Hello. How was Gen Con, buddy?
It was surprisingly awesome. And yeah. I say surprisingly like I expected it to suck. I didn't expect it to suck.
That is sort of the implication there. Yeah.
But I didn't expect it to be as big as it was. I kind of went in thinking like it was going to be like MomoCon-esque size, kind of relatively small, but of people all over the place. No, it was like pack size. It was
nice.
Over 70,000 people were there. The show floor was huge. Board games everywhere. It was very similar to PAX in that the developers of board games were like, come play our game and we'll sit down with you for 15 minutes and play with you. And it was crazy. It was really awesome. I loved it.
And this was in Indianapolis, right?
Indianapolis, mm-hmm. Which is probably the only thing that ever happens in Indianapolis other than straight up the airports, everything in the city, there's just racing cars and everybody's really pumped about their Indy 500.
Yeah, I imagine the pilots will probably try to warm up for their round in the 500 every now and then, right?
Yeah, I imagine.
Mm-hmm.
Well, but it was great.
Michael A.L. Fox, welcome back, buddy. How you doing?
Doing better. Thank you for having me back and surviving the heat just like all you boys. You know, it's no different up here in Canada. So
you're filling our Canadian quota.
Right, yeah, we needed
we got an egg quota and a Canadian quota, and usually Ryan fills both. So the two of you make up one Ryan.
Good. Man, I'm Denmark and he's Poland, and that makes Canada.
Yep.
Is there official heritage you're representing there, Austin? I didn't know if you just picked that one.
No, Poland is, I just like Poland.
Okay, that's cool.
It's just pretty much the extent of it.
That's a good reason. Austin, welcome back as well. How you doing, man?
Yeah, doing good. Doing really good.
What you guys been playing this week?
Pokemon, actually.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Yeah, Soul Silver, getting ready for that Sun and Moon hype, even though it's like 4 months away or something.
You gotta get in there early, though. Fox, what about you, man?
I'm Rimworld. Crazy.
Rimworld all day, every day? Oh, goodness.
Yeah, I'm getting good, though. Well, I told you guys, I streamed for a few hours last night. I started a new one, and Nick is your mother.
Good.
Yeah, and lady. And you're a lady as well, Bear. And you are Dan Giesling's lover.
Yeah, I heard you saying that. That's real exciting.
So Dan Giesling is my son-in-law? Or I don't know if they're married.
Well, they're not married. They're just lovers.
What do you call someone who's not married but is your daughter's lover?
Soon to be son-in-law.
Significant other is probably the
I love RimWorld, and I love that we're all playing with, like, the NLSS names, which is wildly different stories. In mine, Bear, you've been consistently hitting on Kate, and Kate keeps turning you down, and you are about to go on a mental break because you've been rejected, like, 7 times. It's the best. Kate is a former sex slave.
Oh,
I just showed up, and it said sex slave, and I was like, all right, whatever, come on in.
Man. Isn't that's like the foundation of the game is that you're all ending up on these RimWorld planets, weirdly enough, with the name of the game, right? But they've already developed enough to the point where they have sex slaves now. That's that might be like one of the first
evolutions.
NL's character can't be mad because I'm NL's lover, so he's not upset.
Well,
there is a command to eat people, right? Maybe they're just looking at it in a slightly different way.
That's true.
They're adding drugs in the next alpha.
Don't you try it.
What's like the craziest thing you can command a person to do in RimWorld right now, besides eating people, apparently?
I mean, you can just have them euthanize their own friends.
I haven't played RimWorld, but I've watched Fox play it and Ryan play it for a few minutes, and I think the craziest thing that I want to do is have them dig their own graves and then use it as punishment in case they don't work properly that day. So they'll get sentenced to sit in their own grave for 24 hours if they don't do enough work.
Man,
I like that. The craziest thing I've done, I think it was suggested a few times last night, and I really like it. So when you get raided by people, you can, you know, shoot them down, and then if they're not dead, you can capture them and bring them back to health.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll do that, and then you can look at their recruitment, their chance of actually recruiting them into the colony, and if it's too high, then there's no point in bothering. So what you then do is you give some practice to the doctors, and Ryan in my world is the doctor, which is awesome. So you just cut off their legs and you give them peg legs, and then you
and then you release
and
them.
Then you release them. And I had this happen to one guy. I released him, and then like an hour later, he came back with four other dudes. and my turrets and my hog just shredded him apart. He died.
He was pissed, man. He went and got his friends, and he's just like hobbling back into his camp with his two peg legs, like, you won't believe what they did to me.
It's so good.
That's incredible,
man.
You
guys make me want to try this game every time.
Yeah,
I hear about
oh god, it's like all the
something crazier.
It really is just like it's the foundation of a great procedurally generated storyteller, more or less, is what RimWorld boils down to for me. And that alone is probably enticing enough for a lot of people. Clearly, it is. So that's great.
Real good.
Mm-hmm. We're gonna talk about some other games here as well. The docket for today includes the international currently going on, literally happening as we speak. The international 6, right? This is TI6.
Yes.
Going down for Dota 2, and there was an insane game that happened a few days ago. We want to just touch on that real quick. Also, THQ Nordic is a thing that exists now. Nordic Games rebrands as THQ Nordic, and the implications of that we'll be discussing today. Rocket League Rumble and the RLCS wrapped up this week. We're going to talk about the new game mode coming to Rocket League in September. Also, Pokemon Uranium, another Metroid 2 remake. Both games that are very vulnerable to the legal proceedings of Nintendo, but also very exciting at the same time. And a few games on the docket as well today. We're going to be talking about Infectinator Survivors, Worms WMD, Reigns, Kingdom New Lands, and there's this little game called No Man's Sky that came out this week. I'm going to be talking about that for a little bit. But for now, we'll talk about a game that's already achieved worldwide in global popularity. We're talking about the international and Dota 2. Austin, now, okay, let me try a little fancy thing here for you. I want you to describe what took place in Game 1 between America's Evil Geniuses and, I want to say, China's eHome?
Yes. China, yeah.
I want you to do that while I do my best impersonation of the crowd during the Dota 2 International. Okay? So you go ahead and start.
Well, I only got to watch the last 8 minutes of the game, so I'm just going to go through those 8 minutes. Wait, was that a reference to the woos of yesterday?
Yeah.
All right, because that happened after the game. That was so annoying. Maybe we can talk about that after. Give me flashbacks.
Man. I love that scream.
I just want to get up and leave. You don't. No, you don't love that scream.
No, you
don't
no,
know
I
what
do.
That scream entails.
Imagine...
It brings me back to E3 also with the screaming lady.
Oh, God.
Oh, yeah, that was great. Oh, man. Imagine that, but like every 12 seconds during games as like commentators are trying to describe what's going on in the match. It's like silent in the crowd apart from a few assholes going, "Wah! I want attention!"
They were like wooing, but they were wooing at like this perfect like decibel level that it just pierced the caster's microphones. And the game was almost unwatchable.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
There's actually a bunch of pictures that surfaced like shortly after that game where the casters were just turning around and pointing like at this like at the crowd and just being like, "Stop, fucking!" I think there's a video. The dude's just like, "Fucking stop!" And sure enough, it did actually. I don't know if the Valve guys stepped in and said like, "Hey, we'll kick you out" or something, but they did. Someone was trying to keep it going, but it was only like one or two dudes. Everyone else had given up on it, so it did eventually stop. But
it was about laser pointers, right?
It was
it was ridiculous. But sorry, yeah, dude, the game that we were just trying to describe actually was quite ridiculous, though.
It was the entire, from what I heard, the early game and the mid game was just nonstop fighting. Like, I think the kill score was like 40 to 40 something at the end.
Something
of it,
like a kill a minute, I think they were averaging.
It was a lot, yeah, and that's a really fast paced game. But what was extremely exciting was the end of the game was one of the best endings in Dota history, maybe even in just esports history. Like, there's this thing called Mega Creeps, which I'll do a quick run over if you haven't played Dota, but basically getting Mega Creeps is like winning. If you get Mega Creeps, you basically 99.9% chance you've won the game. Out of every Dota 2 game that's ever been played competitively, only 30 some odd times has anyone won against Mega Creeps, and that's thousands and thousands of games. So the chances are very slim, and most of those wins are like they don't even like kind of count because they're like wins against mega creeps within like 10 seconds of them getting mega creeped. So what EG did was they got mega creeped by Ehome, and their base was just destroyed, and they somehow pulled off the win like 2 or 3 minutes later by pushing through the mega creeps and wiping Ehome a couple more times. It was absolutely insane to watch, because not only did they do that against like, you know, another competitive team, they did it against like the favorite to win the tournament, which is Ehome. So that just doesn't happen. It's not supposed to anyway.
This, like, we are normally not a show that would even like talk about the international, apart from maybe like acknowledging that it's happening and the fact that they have a $20 million prize pool, which is also pretty ridiculous. But I actually ended up going back and watching quite a bit of this VOD. It was like one of the craziest gaming spectacles I've ever seen, man. And you set the stage a little bit too, but talk about like how this is the international. This is the biggest stage on earth, basically, as far as esports are concerned right now.
Pretty much in like top eight, every game is the difference between millions of dollars in prize money.
Mm-hmm.
Like if you going from like, I don't know what the exact numbers are, but going from like fifth to fourth is like you're getting an extra $1 million or $2 million or something in prize money.
I've got the bracket up right here. So we're looking at like, so that round they were playing in against Ehome, that was the second round of the upper bracket, and if you drop down and you lose at that stage, you're finishing fifth or sixth, which is like 900,000 for the team, and then you move up one place from that, that's another $500,000 for the team, one more place is another $500,000, but the biggest jump, of course, is going to be from the runner-up to the winner, which is $6 million, or nearly $6 million. Yeah. Just for that one position placement. So I mean, these are huge stakes that they're playing for, and that was the first time coming back from Mega Creeps in the international too. Ridiculous.
Yeah, first time it's happened at TI.
Mm-hmm.
I don't understand. Like, I don't understand why other esports don't adapt what Valve has done with Dota with the Compendium. Compendium is a fucking genius product for the fans of the game, because you buy a Compendium, you get a bunch of in-game skins and treasures, and you can build like your fantasy team, and if they do well, you get like rewards and all this stuff, like straight up full on like fantasy esports stuff that you can do, as well as like a percentage of that goes directly into the prize pool.
Yeah.
So the more that they sell, the bigger the prize pool, and you're funding partially, as well as Valve ponying up a few million themselves or whatever, however they're doing it this year. It's such a good idea. I would love to see other esports do it.
One of the things I think some people don't realize is that it's also insanely smart financially for Valve, because Valve takes 3/4 of the, only 1/4 of it goes to the prize pool. Yeah. Valve gets the other 3/4. So they're banking like $60 million off of this too. So it's wins all
sure,
around.
I'm
really.
Sure putting up, throwing the TI6 though is expensive as well. Like, I'm curious how much it costs them to even produce it and hire all those casters and all that other stuff.
Just
so.
Renting out Key Arena.
The
for
production
like
value
gotta be.
Is pretty terrific this year
really
too.
Good.
You see, like, they've got the little virtual characters in front of the stations on the stage. That's fantastic.
They're going all in this year. Last year they did well. They improved, but it was still, you could still tell it was like a, you know, online Twitch thing. There was some it wasn't top quality, but now they've got like, they got like that. It feels like a sporting event now. They cut away to like the outside crew, the inside crew.
But they
got
still
like,
keep it perfectly hilarious a lot of the time. See the point where they took the four like guys sitting around the table talking about it and replaced them all with puppets?
That was great.
Awesome.
No, they have a great sense of humor.
Yeah.
For sure.
But that was just, I thought, particularly noteworthy. And you don't even really necessarily need to understand a whole bunch of what happens in Dota 2. A sort of passing understanding of it would certainly help, but you could still go and check out the VOD of that game. Because
I'm assuming they do what they did last year, where they have a stream that's dedicated directly at beginners.
Mm-hmm. I don't know if they have it that this year. I think they had it last year, actually.
They did have it last year, I'm pretty sure.
I know they had it for a long time in TI3. If they had it last year, it wasn't as big as it was that when they first did it. But you can go watch that video and just listen to the crowd. Like, all you have to do is listen to the crowd, and you'll kind of understand how ridiculous it is. You have an entire section of the crowd. They have a much larger Chinese audience this year, actually, in the crowd than other years. Like, they have a whole section, which, like, you know, in the past, it was pretty much a completely U.S. biased crowd. So there's people on both sides cheering, both teams going crazy, and it's the atmosphere is incredible. So
has, pardon my ignorance, has the international always taken place in America?
Yes, it's always been in Seattle. It didn't go to Key Arena until TI4, though.
Got it.
But
okay.
It's always been in Seattle, yeah.
I would like to see an international take place in China or Korea or something like that, man.
They instituted a new major system where there's the international and three majors, and there's a major in Shanghai, there's a major in Manila, and there's a major in Frankfurt. So they are branching out
nice.
A little bit.
How you doing up there, buddy? Hey, finger guns.
All right. Making love to the camera for you.
Yeah, sure. Well, that's the international. I just wanted to give it a little bit of its time in the spotlight. Let's move on to Nordic Games, rebranding as THQ Nordic. So let me give the primer for this one real quick. If you don't recall, back in 2013, I believe it was, THQ filed for Chapter 11 bankruptcy. They are the development team behind such series as Darksiders, Red Faction, I think Supreme Commander might be another one. They've got quite a few. And they unfortunately were not seeing the greatest of times back in 2013. They did have to liquidate their assets and sell them off to a whole bunch of different developers. I think Sega picked up a few of them. I know Deep Silver got a couple. And then Nordic Games, weirdly enough, ended up with the majority of the haul coming out of that THQ liquidation. So Nordic Games came away with Darksiders. They had, let's actually take a look here. Yeah, they got the entire list here of things they acquired from THQ. So they got MX versus ATV, Red Faction, Frontlines, Destroy All Humans, which I didn't realize was something that they still wanted to maintain, but sure enough, there it is.
They get another one of those out.
Yeah, that'd be nice. Yeah, I could definitely play another Destroy All Humans. So yeah, they got a good list there. Now, seems Nordic kind of recognizes the fact that whenever Nordic Games is brought up, the first question on everybody's mind is, who the fuck is Nordic Games? So they've decided to address that issue by rebranding as THQ Nordic. And coming from the mouth of the CEO, it sort of sounds like they basically acknowledge that that's exactly the situation here. So when Nordic says that they want to change the name to shape our business in a meaningful way going forward, he also says, on a personal note, having worked in the industry since 1993, I have a lot of respect for what THQ accomplished in the video game marketplace. Their licensed and eventually hardcore games portfolio provided a lot of fun to millions of players, me included. So that's kind of neat. But yeah, this is big news this week. THQ Nordic now exists. So are you guys hoping for anything in particular coming out of this studio? They've announced that they've got 23 unannounced projects in the works right now, many of which are THQ properties, or at least based on THQ properties.
How do you even have 23?
That's a very good question.
Yeah. How many of those are game design docs?
Do they even have 23 employees there? I don't understand.
It could be one title that's on like six different platforms that are all being individually developed.
Yeah, that's true. Mm-hmm.
I don't think I've played a THQ game in like 10 years. So
yeah,
you know, the Darksiders. I'll be happy with that.
Now, I know we've got Darksiders Remastered on the way, and I'm pretty sure then Nordic has got to be spearheading the development there then, right? Sounds like
Darksiders Definitive Edition came out a while ago, if that's what you mean.
That was
another thing.
That was Darksiders 2 Remastered.
Oh, they're remastering the original.
Yeah, and that one's slated for 2017, I think.
That seems very odd to do that.
They remastered the second one before the first one?
Yeah, sure enough they did.
The second one is, in my opinion, better, so I understand.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I feel like I'm a dick for saying this, but mostly their whole portfolio is like games that were kind of okay and then got worse.
You're not wrong, I don't think. Like,
I don't really want to play any more of those games. Like, any of
all the N64 wrestling games were.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that was a THQ license as well. Forgot about that one.
Was THQ Tony Hawk games?
I don't know. That
was NeverSoft?
Yeah, that was NeverSoft.
Yeah.
Tony Hawk is fucking dead.
It is, right.
Done.
Yo, he just did a 900 again, and he's like 50 years old or 46.
No, I'm talking about the video game.
Tony Hawk, the person,
him,
is alive and well, I think.
No, he's fine. The games are done.
And of course, NeverSoft is also defunct now as well. Man, nobody's excited for some remastered THQ properties, huh?
I would like another Darksiders, and I would like another Destroy All Humans. I'd take either one of those happily. I think Darksiders is great, and Destroy All Humans until the later ones was really fun.
Yeah.
I quite liked Red Faction. I really wish they would keep working with the GeoMod technology in new applications. Yeah. Guerrilla was like all right, but it was pretty boring, to be honest. I'd rather they went back to the original first-person shooter. formula. As far as Darksiders, though, I found that game really bland. It was just so, like, trying to be unoffensive, and it didn't really have much to say. I don't know. It wasn't much for me.
Yeah. Whatever, Nick. You're bland, all right? Fuck you!
Yeah, I know.
There's actually a... The process of Nordic Games as a company... I'm trying to pull up the wiki article here, because it's very interesting. The way they went from Nordic to where they are now. I want to give you the quick breakdown. So... at the beginning of the 1990s, it was Lars, I'm going to butcher this name, but Wingfors founded a company named LW Comics. They reshifted to video games in 93, and then in 2000, British retailer Gameplay.com bought them for £6 million. So that was a pretty good purchase price for Lars right there. And then right after the dot-com bubble there in 2000-2001, Lars bought back his the retail division for one Swedish krona, or seven pence.
Wow. Wait, really?
Yeah. So he sold it for £6 million, and then a year later bought it back for one krona or 7 pence. So that was
the best deal in the history of time.
Shrewd businessman right there. Yeah, well done, Lars. Then it was announced that they acquired assets from Joe Wood, which was one of their first major video game asset acquisitions. That included such things as Yoga Wii, Arcania, Panzer Elite, and Legend of K. So, you know, big sellers there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Then beyond that, they went on to acquire the remaining properties, as we mentioned, of THQ as part of that company's liquidation, including Darksiders, Red Faction, etc., etc. Apparently, they also took over the boxed release of Alan Wake back in 2012, too. So they've been... This company has just been like... They have interjected themselves into the video game industry by virtue of just, like, taking a bunch of these either defunct or liquidated assets from different companies. And now, all of a sudden, they're in, like, a not... strong but significant position in the industry just by virtue of having done that. So I think it's interesting to, or it'll be interesting to see what THQ Nordic does moving forward. If they can't do anything beyond just remastering a few old THQ franchises, then I don't know, but
I was freaking out.
Where's the passion?
Where's the passion, yo? I'm going to buy my way to the top. You can't do that.
You take
shit
issue
in my
with
book.
This approach, Malf?
I do. You know, games are art and fun and creativity and storytelling. They're like, all right, let's just buy up all these properties and then just remaster them. They're not even, like, continuing the story. Remastering is, like, okay. I'm not against it for games like, like Shadow of the Colossus or something, so I can actually run it on modern hardware. But, like,
sure.
I just think it's, like, their way of saying, like, we don't really have any good ideas. We're just in it for the money.
And
it seems like they just want to make money, yeah. That's what it sounds like.
And
yeah.
I get that. You know, as a business, every business, you should be concerned about, you know, okay, is this profitable? Can I make a living on it? But that shouldn't be your sole goal, I feel. But, you know.
I mean, the proposition of doing remasters is a never-ending idea. Every time you finish a remaster, the development period of 2 or 3 years ends up necessitating another one because the hardware keeps changing.
Especially now.
So,
it's a never-ending well of money, is what you're here right now. Every 4 years, I can make bank.
Guys, I've got a great idea.
Okay,
we're gonna make the first modular video game framework. So it's like you make the game, but you somehow make it easy to just swap in and out like higher resolution graphics or something like that. Mm-hmm. I don't know. It's like we'll figure it out. We'll solder some things together. And then we don't have to remake the game, per se.
That's all they do, right? When they're remastering something, they just build a new thing and then solder it onto the old game.
Yeah, they just take two discs and just, like, glue them together.
Yeah, I gotcha.
I was reading up on Skyrim, right? Because they're doing the remaster of that.
Yeah.
And because people were asking, oh, why don't you do it with Oblivion or whatever? But essentially, they took the engine that they made Skyrim with. They updated it or upgraded it, made Fallout 4.
Yeah.
So they just basically loaded it up, I guess, and put in some new texture.
It's going from a 32-bit to a 64-bit, so it's going to make modding way easier for a lot of people, and the system will be able to handle a lot more mods as well.
Yeah.
The 64-bit's going to be nice.
Hmm.
I'm excited about that. I'm gonna play through it again for sure.
Hell yeah!
You know how there's the remake of Call of Duty 4 coming out with the new one.
Yeah.
Yep.
I wonder if that's the same engine that they've used for every single Call of Duty, and also with just better textures or something.
I don't know.
Because they've stuck with that same engine for years. So I doubt they made a new one for this remaster.
I mean, it certainly wouldn't be financially viable to do so, right? If you're looking at... They're making Call of Duty Infinite Warfare. I don't know if they would like want to develop an entire new engine just to release alongside Infinite Warfare this remastered version of COD4. That would be a little bit overkill.
Just curious. It seems kind of funny that they would make a new version of the same game with the same engine.
Yeah,
like
but
years later.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if I even disagree with you here, Fox, honestly, as far as THQ Nordic's history is concerned. I mean, they've shown what they're going to be over like the course of the last 15 years in you know, by virtue of them only pumping out acquisitions from other companies or sort of just like tacking themselves on to distribution of different games. Like they're listed as a distributor for both Ori and the Blind Forest and The Vanishing of Ethan Carter, weirdly enough, but both of those are simply for like certain platforms of those games. So I think they only handled the PS4 release of The Vanishing of Ethan Carter, and then they only handled the PC distribution of Ori and the Blind Forest in 2016. So this is an interesting company, and for them to now like wear the THQ moniker, like you got to wonder where that's going to move forward to. Although I guess for THQ, I mean, really the only place to go was up after you declare Chapter 11 bankruptcy and liquefy all your assets. So, you know, like,
really, I mean, like,
where are you gonna go?
That maybe point? It's just a money laundering scheme.
Maybe.
THQ stands for try hard quit.
Oh, man. Wow.
Oh, shit.
It's actually
on that note.
It's actually Toy Headquarters Strimmer. I don't know if you knew that.
Shit.
Well, okay. That's good shots fired at the end there, though. Fuck you, THQ Nordic. Let's go on to our next topic.
Let's do it.
Let's talk about the RLCS. All right. Anybody watch the RLCS besides me this week? Come on, man. Come on, man. You can be excited about this.
I watched the final series.
Was good, though.
No, I'm sure that show was great.
Mm-hmm.
It's a good series. Honestly, it's a great spectator sport.
Yeah,
The client for spectating seems pretty good. The casters were really good. I can't claim super experience. I was just watching that one little final, but everything seemed really solid. And the crowd seemed into it. And mm-hmm. It was just all around a good first championship or something like that.
Definitely a good first championship. I think it's important to emphasize the first there because there were some hiccups. You know, I think it was to be expected. There was a little bit of difficulty in transitioning between games and stuff like that, but they are working out the kinks. But yeah, like you said, I think it's a great spectator esport. I really enjoyed watching the RLCS. It's so fast-paced, too, compared to something like the International. I mean, you got five-minute games, and there's action happening constantly. So this is like the opposite of the spectrum, essentially, for folks that have been watching things like the International or the LCS. I think it's going to be a great, welcome new addition to esports. I really hope the scene starts to blossom, too. I think now that there's some serious money involved with it, it'll get a lot more teams to actually be interested in playing. So I'm very excited to see how it moves forward. But the big news coming out of the RLCS is Rocket League Rumble. It's here. Ooh. Yeah, man. Oh, Mathis, tell me how excited you are about Rocket League Rumble.
I'm so excited. I still won't reinstall the game.
You don't want to use spikes?
I'm too nervous that if I reinstall the game, I'm never going to stop playing it. So I'm going to leave it uninstalled.
You don't want to use the disruptor to force your opponent to drive uncontrollably?
I know I'm being cynical about it because like I'm fucking Rocket League like news is like once a month, but it's cool. I'm glad that they're still supporting the game and I'm glad that they're still adding to it because there's clearly a community that still plays the hell out of it, and that's good.
Hell yeah, I'm glad. Man.
Good for them.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
This new mode, I actually am pretty excited about it though. This is something that I think a lot of people have been asking for in Rocket League for a while, is just like this Mario Kart-esque addition to it. And there's nothing wrong with it. It's all happy good news.
Free? Is it free? Is it a free edition?
I believe so, yes.
Mm-hmm. That's really good.
Yeah. I don't know.
The basketball mode was pretty fun. So, mm-hmm. And that was a relatively simple, I think, little game mode. So this seems like a little bit more complicated. Could be a lot more fun.
Definitely.
I've got a good idea that they should do.
Please.
It should have a Hot Wheels mode. You get to build loop-de-loops and ramps and shit.
Oh,
in a,
yeah. Forge
just a
mode.
Big old, like, Mad Max world with canyons and shit.
Dude, combine. Oh, my God. You've got...
Isn't that a game that already exists?
Gas Guzzlers.
Maybe. It was a racing game that Ryan, I played with you, Nick, like years ago.
I think I know
ago.
What you're talking about.
Ubisoft. Oh, God, what's the name of that game?
You're talking about, like, Burnout?
No.
Like, the party crash
it's
mode?
A big
which
build
be-
racing game where you make these huge, like, sprawling
Trackmania?
Racetracks.
Trackmania,
yeah.
I think is on. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's
good anyway,
stuff.
Continue.
I think you're onto something. I think we should combine the best parts of Rocket League and Trials. We can get like a 3D Trials going on, man. You think about something like that?
That's legit, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh.
Because like the thing about Rocket League that makes it so good is that it just feels really good. Like when you're just moving, the movement, the boost, being able to like, you know, fly, all of that movement just makes it so much fun to play. I think putting that in any other kind of car-based game could be really, really good.
Hell yeah.
So I get to totally see like a racing game where you know, it's just a track, but it has like, you know, you can't go out of bounds, so you can use the flying, go up on the ceiling, do crazy shit like that. Like,
oh,
I see that working out entirely.
I want to play this.
Did you guys ever play Burnout Takedown?
Mm-mm.
No.
Maybe back in the day?
Yo, really?
Oh, no.
That was the best one.
I agree.
Yeah, it did. It sounds familiar.
It's like you do races and you try and take out dudes, but they had this one mode in particular called Party Mode, which is essentially what they use. Like Burnout guys made the destructive golf game, which I guess is kind of the same premise, but golf. I don't know how that turned out, but basically you start this map, you like run, you do this jump, and then you get to do slow-mo, and your point is to try and make the car just cause as much destruction of all the vehicles and chain it up.
I remember that.
You mean crash mode, right?
And yeah, and so What's-His-Face did the AMA on Reddit. Oh, you know, we made Burnout, blah, blah, blah. And people are like, so when are you going to make another Burnout Takedown? I would play the shit out of that. If Rocket League added another mode like that, oh my gosh. They'd make so much money.
Wasn't that Sean Murray, actually, that worked on
Hello
Burnout?
Games guy? Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I thought so.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Funnily enough,
quintillion modes for Rocket League.
God, let me know when it's time to talk about that.
Sure, dude, I got you. We're always going to be on top of the Rocket League news. Rocket League Rumble, though, is slated for release in September. Let me give you the breakdown of the many modes and options for items you'll have, including the Boot, Disruptor, Freezer, Grappling Hook, Haymaker, Power Hitter, and Swapper. And Rocket League Rumble. It's happening in September. Let's move on to Pokemon Uranium. After 9 years, Pokemon Uranium is finally being released as a .exe for your PC. Austin, have you been following this at all?
I've heard a bunch about it. Mm-hmm. I've seen it a couple times. You always hear, if you play Pokemon, you always hear about it off in the distance. Like, oh, Pokemon Uranium. It'll be finished one day. Mm-hmm. It's finally finished. And from what I've heard, it's apparently really good. It has apparently about like 100 new like Pokemon that are designed by the developers. And
yeah,
I've heard that it's all pretty similar to what you'd see from Nintendo in a new Pokemon. So I'm tempted to try it. Honestly, it seems like it could be really good. It's no Pokemon Apex. Don't get me wrong, but
sure,
it could be. I'm willing to look into it for sure as a Pokemon fan.
Definitely. It's only a matter of time, of course, until Nintendo issues a takedown notice for it, but
yeah.
We'll just...
Surprised they made it 9 years without it happening.
Yeah, I mean, the argument being made there, too, is that like if Nintendo was going to do something about it, they would have done it by now, because this has been in the news before. People have been talking about this for quite some time, and now it's out, so who knows? Maybe they'll let this one slide. Do you think so, Nick? No?
Nintendo has to protect their trademarks.
Yeah, it's dangerous.
Because of the legal system and things.
Mm-hmm.
I understand why that's the explanation that's given, and this was, you know, AM2R, the Metroid 2 remake. Dude worked on it for 10 years, and they get a... I think it was... Was it not a cease and desist? It was a Millennium Takedown Act thing. DMCA, yeah. And that was really disappointing. And then everyone was just like, hey, well, you know, that's what was going to happen. You know, they've got to protect their trademarks and their IPs. It's like, yeah, but they should, like, make something in their IP then that's actually entertaining.
So, we can go down that road if we want.
We can go down that
road. I can't wait to see the reviews on Federation Force, honestly. Guys. The copies have gone out.
Stop.
We will know in a week.
I hope it gets amazing reviews.
I hope it gets demolished just so I can feel a little bit better when I go to sleep at night.
I don't know. I think it
gets amazing reviews as well.
There's probably some legal thing maybe where they couldn't have some sort of takedown notice until the game is actually released. Who knows? They could have spent 9 years making the game. Oh, unofficial Pokemon, and maybe they changed the name to, you know, something that isn't Pokemon related, right?
That would be Nomacop. That's Pokemon backwards, for the visual learners.
Nintendo, No, go ahead.
I was just going to say, too, you know, has Nintendo, like, 9 years ago, was it a common thing for them to be such asshats? Like, we had all the whole YouTube Let's Play thing and whatnot. If I'm making this game and I've already sunk, like, 5 or 6 years into it, I'd probably just be like, well, I'll just finish it anyways. Like, even though I know Nintendo's going to take it down, like...
You'd be surprised.
You know what Nintendo did for Metroid's 30th anniversary?
Nothing.
Fucking nothing. Nothing. You know who did do something? The developer of AM2R, and they give him shit.
You can't
so fuck
top,
off, Nintendo.
You can't top Metroid Other M. You don't get better than that. Why try?
They didn't even tweet. They didn't even say a word.
They didn't even tweet, yep.
They tweeted some bullshit about some like Sonic Olympic Games stick character that I've never heard of.
Well, if it's a birthday, then 30 counts. It's a big deal. If it's an anniversary, that's like not the anniversary of your birth, but like of your marriage, 30 doesn't mean shit. It's what is it? Is it 10, 25, 50? So they're waiting
Why
20
is
years.
There
then they'll,
anything
then they'll
for 25 either. And there was a meme photo or a meme picture that came out that was like, here's the party of Mario and Zelda celebrating their 25th. And here's a picture of Samus over here crying next to a cupcake. Same thing.
There's Nintendo has an interesting relationship with these fan games. I don't know if you guys heard about something called Project M. I don't know if you guys talked about it on the
Smash
podcast
Brothers
before.
Game, right?
Vaguely familiar, yeah.
Well, there's an interesting story with that because Project M was in development for like, I don't even know how many years, a lot of years. And it was basically modded Brawl, I think. And it was basically taking all of the awful things out of Brawl and like balancing it in their own way and making it to like a mix between Smash 4 and Melee. And people liked it a lot. And it kind of just sat on its own. Nintendo didn't really mess with it. But as Nintendo finally started to embrace competitive Smash, like a couple years ago, they started sponsoring Smash events and all this. Project M just stopped. The developers on their website made a post and were like, we're done with Project M. Nintendo is not forcing us to stop, but we are randomly and completely done with Project M. We're no longer continuing development. Don't ask us.
This is verbatim from the post, right? Randomly and for no reason done doing this.
You can no longer stream Project M on Twitch, I don't think. Because I think all the Project M tournaments are on Hitbox now. And people, big community figures of Smash, like, just totally won't even talk about Project M anymore. Some of the casters, some of the people who run the streams, and it just disappeared. And they say it was not Nintendo, but it's very clearly Nintendo told them to stop, and they just completely halted it. And it's kind of scary, actually.
Well, Nintendo is now, like, they've become directly involved with the Smash tournaments here, too,
yes.
So it's certainly not far-fetched to assume that they had something to do with that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they, and it's funny, because Nintendo really, like, they started supporting Smash 4, and they kind of were just, like, looking at Melee off in the distance, just like, yeah, that's there, we won't, because originally, remember, like, the whole debacle where they removed Melee from EVO, that whole thing. Mm-hmm. But finally, like, this EVO, Nintendo was like, hey, look, it's Melee. Melee's on. Go watch Melee after. So even getting them to embrace their own game
was
difficult
enough.
Well,
they can't sell any more copies of Melee. That's the issue.
Right. But they finally realized there was some value there because, you know, Melee cross-promotes with Smash 4 and all that, so.
I feel like Nintendo were, like, the fan game Men in Black. They like come out and clean up any idea that you had that someone else was working on a property, and then they neuralize you.
Yeah.
So you can never remember that someone else had this idea.
We did not stop you from making this game.
I feel like, does that not go through somebody's head when they start the project? Like, maybe they won't be happy about this. You know, Star Trek, there's the fan-made Star Trek movie or whatever.
Axanar? Yeah.
And I posted the story. So GoldenEye 007 has a PC remake with, like, updated textures. It's online multiplayer.
So that's not official either, then.
That's the unofficial
remake.
It's available for free, apparently, but who knows what the heck is going to happen. I guess so. I mean, that was Rare, right? And then Rare was bought by Microsoft, so maybe they won't give a shit.
Who even owns that 007 IP in general for video games, right?
Like, oh, my God, Chad.
There's
look at
so
this.
Much legal shit there.
Look at this, Chad. If you haven't seen this yet, I'm just watching it for the first time. Oh, my God. My nostalgia goggles are just... They're just leaking tears of joy right now.
Nostalgia.
Thanks, man. I'm sorry. They posted it on The Verge. I'm pretty sure Verge gets enough traffic to get the game shut down.
Of course I would know what the fan movie is. I'm a huge Star Trek fan.
Well, damn. All right. Well, we got the
GoldenEye
thing coming.
Can't wait for STD to come out.
What?
Star Trek Discovery. That's the new CBS show. The show that's being released. STD. I was like, you couldn't have, like... not pick Discovery, like they're labeling it DSC, but I'm like, no, it's STD. Good job.
I want them to tweet like, come watch Star Trek STD, pass it on. Retweet this tweet.
Genius.
Come watch
Nintendo,
STD.
Didn't Nintendo make a GoldenEye remake recently, or am I crazy? I thought they
no,
did.
No, Nintendo didn't make it. It was some other company, and it was pretty bad, is what I heard.
Yeah,
I don't know. It was for 360.
Oh, okay. I just remember hearing about that.
Well, you want to tell me more about AM2R, actually, Nick? Because this just does just kind of coincide with the Pokemon Uranium story, too.
Honestly, I haven't played it still, but it's a fan-made remake of the original Metroid 2 that was out on Game Boy, done in the Metroid Fusion engine with a completely redesigned map and apparently much more fun game mechanics. Because honestly, Metroid 2 wasn't all that good. I think most Metroid fans would attest to that. And Metroid Fusion was a lot more enjoyable, at least as far as, you know, navigation in the world and just generally understanding what the hell's going on. Because Game Boy, really tiny screen, and Metroid, pretty big map. Those things don't go very well together. So from what I've heard, it's a big improvement, and I've been looking forward to playing, just haven't gotten around to it yet, but I intend to.
Mm-hmm. And you've got the... You've got the file. You're not
yeah,
a major... All right, good, yeah.
As far as I know, it's still able to be gotten... It's just sort of in the gray area of, like, they don't want it to be out there.
Well, I mean, yeah, there's never anything anyone can effectively do to remove something from the internet once it's there. Yeah. Well, so,
what I mean is there were, like, three different mirrors and a couple of torrents that you could get it from, and, like, I think they only bothered one of the mirrors for whatever reason, so I think you can still get it from the usual channel.
That's just to make the statement. That's just, they push themselves out there
afraid.
To say, hey, you better know darn well that what you're doing is wrong. Don't you do it anymore.
They want it to be known that if you download this, you've been put on a list, and in 5 years, they'll come and take your life.
Metroid 2 was the one that was similar to the original Metroid, which was like one of those really confusing like NES games where... Like, there were things hidden inside of walls, inside of walls, inside of walls. Like Super Metroid, you look at it like, you know, it was a very well-made game. But I think most people don't have super fond memories of the original Metroids. It's kind of the same thing with, like, Link to the Past and the original Zeldas. Like, they're very Nintendo powery, I guess is a good adjective to use for them.
Mm.
Would you agree with that?
Yeah, there's a lot of atmosphere and things that wasn't really present properly in the original. Granted, it had a great soundtrack, but it started to look a bit samey as you went across the map to the point where navigating became a bit of a chore without, you know, having a map next to you in printed out in paper form.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think a lot of people love the original Metroid as much as they had after they've played Super Metroid and seen how it was really kind of supposed to be done. But I appreciate it. Retrospectively, if that's what you can say.
Mm-hmm.
Retroactively.
Right. Right on. Cool. It's Pokemon Uranium, Metroid 2, the AM2R, another Metroid 2 remake. Both available on the internet. you're interested in but playing them for yourself,
don't go get them.
Yeah.
Nintendo said don't.
We do not endorse.
That's right.
No, we do.
I wonder if we actually have to protect ourselves from that now. Jeez, I gotta hold my tongue more often.
Who knows?
Yeah. No. Olympics. Just to get that in there, just to make sure we're gonna
Nintendo comes
that
for
idea.
Us. I'll just like, take that bullet. Just have Nintendo just kill me. I'll be all right with it.
All right. Okay. So, I am genuinely curious which installment in the series this is, what number, but Nick, please do tell me all about Worms WMD real quick as well.
I honestly couldn't tell you what number unless
let's
I looked
find
at the Wikipedia.
Hold on. We need to do our due diligence here. Let's figure out how many there have been before
maybe
now.
Team 17 won't stop until there's 17 worms.
I mean, that makes sense.
It's not going to stop until they stop making
oh
money.
My god, there's so many.
I know! It's so
oh
great.
Oh my god. Like, Worms Armageddon was the one I grew up on, and honestly, I don't think they really needed to do anything else, but I guess they want more money.
All right, y'all.
I guess.
You ready for this? Here we go. The full rundown from 1995 on. Let's do it. Worms. Worms Reinforcement. Worms The Director's Cut. Worms 2. Worms Armageddon. Worms World Party. Worms 3D. Worms Forts Under Siege. Worms 4 Mayhem. Worms Open Warfare. Worms Again. Worms Open Warfare 2, Worms A Space Oddity, Worms 2 Armageddon, Worms Reloaded, Worms Battle Islands, Worms Ultimate Mayhem, Worms Revolution, Worms for Facebook, closed in 2013, Worms 3, Worms Clan Wars, Worms Battlegrounds, Worms World Party Remastered, Worms 4,
Worms,
and then finally, entry number 20, I believe, in the series, if I was counting on one hand well enough, Worms WMD. In 2016. Nick, what the hell have they done with this?
I feel like we've opened this in such a terrible way because honestly, this seems like the best Worms game I've played in a good while.
Good! That's wonderful news.
They went back to a 2D presentation. It looks very nice. They've added vehicles and sentry guns and a crafting mechanic, which I'm not entirely sure we needed at all. They've also, like, knocked the number of weapons way down again for some reason, but maybe it's for DLC reasons, I'm not sure yet.
And
they've done crossovers with about 10 different indie games.
I'm seeing the Octane Battle Car makes an appearance, apparently, in there in the trailer.
There's Rocket League, there's Broforce, there's Goat Simulator, there's Payday 2, there's The Escapists.
Hmm.
There's, like, a good five more, which, why are those things involved? Worms is fine without any of that. But, it doesn't actively hamper the game, and it seemed like there was a reasonable amount of single player to play. We played some multiplayer, and it worked just fine. There was no dropping of games. There was no latency issues.
There was a couple of bugs that I was seeing.
Maybe a little bit laggy sometimes, but not worse than the last one, which was in 3D.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. It seems like all in all, it's a better performing Worms game, closer to the Armageddon formula and physics that we liked. But then again, it's not like you couldn't play Armageddon anymore, or World Party for that matter, which was also sort of Armageddon.
What if they're doing like the Microsoft route? You know, the Microsoft form is like, Windows XP, good. Windows, what was the one after that? Vista, shit.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Windows.
You got it. You got it.
I thought Windows for a second, and I'm like, am I still in the calls?
Windows 7, good. Windows 8, bad.
Yeah.
I guess, for the most part, people kind of like Windows 10. So maybe they're doing that to, like, they're stringing people along. So they're intentionally making shitty buggy games, and then they're like, all right, but here's the good one.
Do you think that Microsoft is intentionally putting out shitty OSs as a form of marketing?
Yo, Windows ME stands for many errors. That is a known fact.
Oh, wow.
Oh, man, ME...
Golden age of OS.
Long time ago.
I
don't know. I mean, I've only played a very small amount of Worms now, but I don't. I feel like Shell Shock spoiled me a little bit. Shell Shock Live, because they're kind of the same game, sort of the same idea, and I found Shell Shock to be a lot more variety to it, a lot better combat system, and a lot more faster pace. Worms felt extremely slow while we were playing. We got like two games in like an entire hour and a half, I think. So
wow.
Yeah, it was arduously slow, actually. But we were also using one of the default weapon loadouts, which I usually play on one that's a bit faster than that. I've been a long-time Worms fan, probably since the original one. I had a copy of it for Sega Saturn or something, and I got into it from there. I haven't bought every iteration, which would be quite an undertaking, but I have bought probably more than half of them. And largely, they're the exact same game with a different skin or some different feature set. Right. This one seems like it's the closest thing to a conglomeration of reasonably good features and an okay graphical style and okay netcode. So that's like... that's something to care about if you're a fan of Worms, I guess.
I guess that is sort of like what it's boiled down to at this point. I don't know if there's much else we can tell people about the Worms franchise, you know? It's like you said, it is fairly formulaic. They've gotten to a near annual release schedule here, too. Don't not forget Worms 4 was last year. Worms Battleground was 2014. Like,
They put them up on different platforms, though, is the thing. I don't think all of those have been on PC.
Okay, well, that would make sense then.
Team 17 did a different IP like within the past year or two, right? There was some other game that was non-Worms.
I think Team 17?
Yeah, they did something that was not Worms.
Escapists a few years ago.
That's the one.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that would explain why it's in this Worms game.
Yes.
Because it really has nothing to do with Worms at all.
Yes, you are correct.
They also made Lemmings back in 2006.
I love Lemmings as a kid. That was one of the first games I played. That shit was good.
Mm-hmm.
What do you mean they made it back in 2006? It was from like 92.
They apparently
not older than that.
Well, hold on. No, okay. This is not the correct reference. Yeah, sorry. That's 1991.
All right. I just took a stab at the year.
Yeah, no, that sounded really wrong in my head, and I was like, wait, what? No, that's
2006.
Leisure Suit Larry box office bust. Also a Team 17 product.
Classic.
Yeah.
So what is 2006 Lemmings? Is that like an iOS thing or
that
something
is,
I never knew about?
Yeah, that might just be a mobile
the
release.
The remaster, Nick. They remastered it.
Well, I liked Lemmings. If it came out, I want to maybe play it.
And it might be a mobile game. I don't know exactly what this is referencing,
right,
but yeah.
I'll look it up on my own time. AKA now.
Right. This is your time.
Lemmings Paintball? I do remember Lemmings Paintball. That was all.
Came out on PS3?
Lemmings did?
Yeah, it says Lemmings 2006 PS3.
Lemmings
and there's a picture
PS3.
Of somebody on the cross media bar with a thing they're about to start.
What
That's
do you
weird.
Know? Huh.
All right.
Or you know.
I guess I missed that. Anyway, Worms is pretty good. You should maybe consider it if you're a longtime Worms fan. That's kind of all I have to say about it.
Austin, echo the sentiment?
I think I need to play more. I don't have enough experience to really recommend it or not recommend it.
Fair enough.
I want to know, too, if the single player unlocks stuff. And the Ninja Rope is back to Classic Edition now. You can mess around with it.
So it's got the
You can bounce yourself around and then fly off.
Yeah, Ninja Rope! Now I'm in!
It's kind of a big deal because they fucked Ninja Rope up since the second game and never put it back again.
I'll tell you what, though, man. Armageddon was my shit. That one.
Yes.
That was a family staple for years.
Yeah, it was a great game.
That was real good.
We had that on Sega Dreamcast.
Nice.
It was the
yeah, me too. I played on Dreamcast.
Yeah, it was good, man.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. Good stuff.
All right, Worms WMD is available August 23rd. It's not quite available on Steam yet. It'll be $30 in about 10 days. Mathis, one that I know you've been checking out. It's called Reigns.
Yeah, Reigns is good.
Reigns is
good,
huh?
So, for those who are curious, Reigns is a newly released game on Steam. It's only $3. It's like, it's on iOS, yeah. It's a portable game as well.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, the idea is, like, you rule a kingdom by making decisions in Tinder-style swipes. You decide, basically, yes or no. The game randomly presents you with, like, things that are happening in your kingdom. Maybe there's, like, a fire in your stable, and you have to decide, do you want to, like, save the horses or let it burn? And each one of those affects one of four stats that you have at the top. If one of those stats goes all the way to the bottom, you die. If it goes all the way to the top, you die. So you're constantly trying to keep it in the middle. Every decision you make counts as 1 year. And there's some really fun. It's a great narrative-focused game. There's very little in the terms of gameplay. It's all about just making decisions and seeing what happens when you do it. And I was super surprised at how good it is. It's a lot of fun.
I think it was actually, like, when they were making it and designing it, it started as a mobile game, and I feel like they're just like, well, we could also put this out on Steam, whatever, it's not too much extra work or something. Like, it's just, like you said, Tinder style. It's designed to play, and it's not bad. I'll play a couple
lifetimes,
I guess. on my way to and fro work. And yeah, it's neat, just the different characters, and they have unlocks and things that kind of keep you like, okay, I'll play one more rain, I'll do one more rain, I keep going and stuff. It's pretty neat, although it's weird though, some of the stuff throws you a curveball, like if you get too rich or something. I've had it where I reach the rich and they're like, here, we're gonna throw you a party, and then you choke on cake and you're dead.
If anyone gets to the top, you die. If anyone gets to the bottom, you die. Usually, like, the ones that get to the top, you die in, like, pretty, like, wonderful ways. I've had the people one, I think it was, get all the way to the top, and my character died, but it's like, nobody hates you, you're long remembered for many years as one of the greatest kings to ever reign,
right.
And you die. And you got banged to death, and that's how you died.
So we'll
But they also do, like, certain things where they can lock one of those. I had it, like, people really wanted me to marry some chick and, like, bang her, so I did. And they're like, that's awesome. You can do anything and you won't displease the people for X amount of years or something. Yeah. So that was really cool. Mm-hmm. I like
that. It's a lot of little things like that that actually like mess with your bars. Because again, it's all about those four stats. And for the most part, when you look at making a decision, it'll show like a small circle or a large circle over one of the stats. And that basically says it's going to affect it small or large. But you don't know if it's going to be a negative effect or a positive effect. So you kind of have to like think about the decision and be like, well, this is going to be good or is it going to be bad? But there are situations in the game that will give you foresight. So I've had a moment where I've eaten something or whatever, and all of a sudden now I know if it's going to be a negative or a positive effect on it for as long as my king is alive, which is great. And there's other just like things like there are stats. I think the Silk Road is one that I've gotten recently where it's a little arrow next to one of the stats. That one is for money particularly. And it in real time, it's just constantly growing. So you're like on a timer. You need to be making decisions quickly and trying to keep the money down because you're just consistently gaining money. And if you get too rich, you're going to die at a party, basically.
I turned it down, and then they were like, how about 20% a year? So I was like, okay. So it went up even faster and lost even quicker. But it's cool. And also, like, you do learn. You get new cards and stuff if you get certain achievements and things like that. And you'll get the same cards, not, like, super often, but you'll get them enough that eventually you'll be like, oh, yeah, this costs money, but it makes the church really mad or something like that. So you recognize them, and that kind of helps you hopefully get further and further.
Yeah, there's a lot of just... It's one of those, like, just branching story games. Like, I don't want to say it's like RimWorld, but a game that every time you play is a little bit different.
Has facilitates a narrative in a similar way to RimWorld.
Mm-hmm. And I played one really quick where I had a son. I was looking to get an heir, and then my son ended up being a dick and challenging me to a duel. And I was like, I'll teach this kid a lesson. Fuck this kid. And he fucking killed me. And now I'm playing as my son.
And that's awesome, though.
You should end up playing CK2, is what it sounds like.
Yeah,
it
does sound it's CK2. Really like, you know, CK2 mashed with Tinder-style decisions. It's all about that.
And like
it's cool.
Value, you don't think it's going to be that deep. And I hesitate to say it's a very deep game because ultimately it is really like swipe left, swipe right. But there's a lot more to it than I initially suspected there to be. There's a good progression system built within it as well. Like, it gives you new objectives every time you start off a new reign, or most of the time when you start off a new reign. And those will be different, unique storylines that you can go down. There's like new characters that will show up that will routinely show up and become part of your narrative too. And you can, like you mentioned, like, there are things that will alter your gain or the way that certain cards interact with you. But there's also instances where, for example, I had one point where I was told, the next person you say yes to will die. So that ended up like making a huge impact on what I had to do moving forward, because I wanted to make sure that I was making the correct decisions, but I also wanted to make sure that I didn't kill somebody that was going to be like of vital importance moving forward. So I wanted.
I immediately killed the bishop. I was like,
there's also kind of sort of like mini games in it. I've had a couple. Well, there's the dueling, right? You can the knight or the general, you can duel him. Mm-hmm. And then there's one where you can explore, what is it, like a cavern or a lair or something like that. So you get to
the choose dungeon?
Choose which rooms and stuff you go into, and that was pretty cool. I fought a dragon as well.
That's awesome.
I died to the skeleton down there.
Oh no.
Is the presentation quality like roughly around how charming the Yogg was? Because it sounds like there's some parallels similar, to that game, too.
I mean, yeah, similar. I mean, I think a lot more basic than the Yogg. Mm-hmm. Like, Yogg had beautiful art. The art looks fine, but
it's a unique style. It's simple, but it's nice. Like, it's pleasant to look at.
It's pleasant to look at.
Oh, nice.
Got it.
Hey, shit. I highly suggest it. It's only $3. It's
easy buy.
Wow, America. It's $4 in Canada.
Oh shit.
It's those cheap games that really give you a lot of hours you wouldn't expect.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Absolutely. This is it's a great mobile game too. This is one of the few mobile games I've enjoyed this year. Just able to pull it up real quick and start off on the lineage again, and it's like it's got that permanent sense of progression too, weirdly enough, for a game like this, where like you can go back and you can see your previous bloodlines and check out what sort of crazy adventures your ancestors got up to. Obviously it's all you, but you know, it's like it's cool to see that retrospective and know what your ancestors did that will maybe even impact the options that you have in the future. So there's a lot of cool longevity to it. Yeah, that's the word.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Good shit.
I like
it. Right there.
It's $3. It's on Steam. It's Reigns, also on Android and iOS. Nick.
Hi.
Hey. We're about halfway through the show. How you doing, man? I just want to check in.
So far, so good. It's gotten a little cooler outside, so I'm feeling a little better than it was at the start.
That's nice.
That's good.
How was Infectinator?
It's a mixed bag with that one, actually. Okay. Cool premise. I'll give you the rundown here. I'm just going to have to read it off the Steam page because it's a conglomeration of a lot of genres here.
Mm-hmm.
So Infectinator Survivors is a randomized permadeath survival simulator that combines RTS tower defense, roguelike, and management simulation gameplay. So let that all sink in.
Yeah.
There were a few words in survival. There that was like, hey, that sounds like
RTS
something I'd play.
RTS tower defense, roguelike, management simulation.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so imagine Game Dev Tycoon, but instead of programming video games, you're building a settlement to survive against zombies.
Oh, now I want to play this, actually.
Now, you'd get your four survivors, or however many you've recruited, and you go off to these procedurally generated buildings to fight zombies and look for loot that you then bring back to your settlement to try and, you know, build it up and keep things going. So it's got a little bit of that Oregon Trail-style randomness, but it's not quite as FTL dynamic, and it actually ends up having more of an emphasis on combat than I would have expected. There's a lot of resource management, keeping your ammo consistent, and you know the graphical presentation of it is pretty charming. Reminds me a little bit of like the kind of flashy kind of games that you see that are sort of just it's like a pretty sort of basic art style, but it gets the job done.
Mm-hmm.
So in my time with it, I played one run, which resulted in the death of all four of my survivors. Eventually, it took me, I think, I survived 4 days. Which you have 15 days to repair your car so you can leave the settlement, otherwise something happens. I guess you get overrun or something. And I did not do very well, but I also didn't really know what I was doing, and I think in 2 or 3 more playthroughs I'd probably be able to progress a bit further. The one thing, though, is a bit tedious starting up. The tutorials were not the best presented, and it took a little bit of figuring out what the hell I was trying to do. And sort of like Isaac, where you kind of really don't know what's important until you've done it, it's got a bit of that experiential thing. Where it's like, all right, I know I want to make some food because you got to eat food, but which piece of food do I want to make? There's a bunch of different pieces, and how do I properly prepare it? And then do I want to spend time upgrading my kitchen so I can prepare food more effectively, or should I be working on my car? There's so many options. And
how long did that run take you?
Get the flow, I don't know. So I think that was about an hour-ish, somewhere around an hour for 4 days. I have a feeling this is a pretty long-term game, although I was taking it quite slow reading everything. Once I went back to it, I imagine I could skip through all the dialogue boxes, maybe cut it down to about 20 minutes to get to where I was. I was also just kind of chatting with chat for a while, too, so it really did lengthen it. Austin was there to watch as well, and I believe he had a few opinions on it, so if you want to take the floor for a sec.
Yeah, I mainly echo what Nick said. The real big negative that I saw, and this is, of course, you know, secondary. Nick was playing, I was just watching, but as he said, the tutorial was just very, very slow, and also there was just too much in it at once. So it felt like you weren't understanding everything, but also it was still taking a long time to tell you things you didn't understand. So I think that hurts the game a lot, because for me, visually, and this might just be more personal, but for me, visually, if I were to see this game and hear it spoken to me, be like, this is what the game is, I wouldn't be horribly interested in this kind of game. So having that and having a really long, monotonous tutorial at the beginning, is not a good combination, and I feel like that could affect or hurt the game pretty significantly.
It needed some help, too, in that it was kind of telling you a lot of obvious stuff, but in sort of a role-playing format, which wasn't helpful in understanding the game mechanics faster. So it was, like, telling you stuff like, you've got to eat food to heal. And it's like, all right, I get it. People eat. Like, I've been a person for a while. I kind of get the eating thing. And I saw the food, and I saw the garden, and I'm like, kind of put two and two together here. And, you know, the basic premise is that there's this guy in this house that's kind of giving you all this information via walkie-talkie, and you don't really get to find out his origin, at least right away. So, I don't know, maybe this guy's screwing you over in the long run, but kind of curious to see where it evolves to, and I imagine there's more survivors to find in the world. It's a pretty huge city, actually, to explore. I don't know how you're going to get it done in 15 days, but maybe there's other caveats to it that I haven't experienced yet. Mm-hmm. It was a mixed bag, like I said, though. Like, I would maybe be interested in playing it again, but the beginning was kind of tedious, so left it up in the air a little bit. It's certainly not bad, and I think for the price, it was like, what, $8.99? Mm-hmm. $8.39 is going up to $11.99 after the sale ends. That's pretty reasonable for what it is. It seems well-made enough that I could be all right with that. Reviews are mostly positive, and it only just came out, so there'll probably still be some patches to round out things. So, you know, ultimately, probably a tentative recommendation if you like that style of game.
So when I see the description for this, it just sort of looks like they're overloading the buzzwords to try to cash in on people seeking that stuff out. Not to suggest that that's what it's doing, but when you're balancing all these different elements, I mean, you've got games that are entirely RTS, entirely tower defense, you know, like they focus 100% on those things. So do you feel like they balance all those different facets of gameplay well enough in Infectinator, or is it sort of just like...
I don't know
like...
if I played enough to know, really. Like I said, it was mostly just about learning the basic mechanics.
Mm-hmm.
What I was surprised by is quite how much actual action happened in the game. I thought it was more of a management game, but you really are kind of leading your characters around click to click, like an RTS. And they do shoot stuff themselves, but they don't always reload themselves, and they don't always make the right appropriate actions. And the zombies seem to never stop coming most of the time, so if you don't pay really careful attention, you'll just end up trapped in a corridor and just get eaten, which is a bit of a drag, because once you lose one of your survivors, you may as well just restart, at least is what happened to me. I lost two at the same time, the other two weren't really able to survive for very long, and I don't know, maybe I could get more of them down the line, but I didn't live long enough to find out. So it's got pretty serious repercussions for if you screw up, which in some ways is actually kind of a good thing because it's a pretty heavy game. It's about freaking the apocalypse, so, you know, not outside of the theme, but a bit jarring if you're not used to how to play the game yet.
Also, I don't know how well you're going to be able to verify the comparison here, but this sort of just seems like a strategy version of Death Road to Canada. Where
Death Road
is like an action game and you're controlling your characters. This is like, go do this, but... Effectively, there's very many thematic similarities that I can draw here, but yeah, that's interesting.
Is there a strategy layer to Death Road to Canada as well, where you're building stuff between missions, or?
No, there is though that like Oregon Trail FTL-esque sort of events thing that pops up every now and then. That will in turn, you know, play into how you manage your resources. So there are resources that you manage in Death Road to Canada, but it's not exactly as comparable, I don't think.
If you put it that way, it does sound pretty similar. Probably one of my favorite things actually was the FTL style event system. I only got to see a couple of them, but it was neat to see that is like, hey, these two people want to enter your settlement. Do you want to let them in? And you can either turn them away or let them in, and then I let them in, find out one of them is infected, turns, and then eats his friend. And then it uses a bunch of your resources in that you lose ammo and you lose supplies getting rid of them and killing them. So, you know, if I would have made the other decision, maybe things would have worked out better, but it's random chance, I suppose.
Yeah, and that's definitely like that Death Road to Canada-esque. So, yeah, and it certainly seems like there's some comparisons to be drawn there. Cool. All right. Yeah, 840 on Steam right now. It's Infectinator Survivors. Awesome. Real quick, before we get into the big one, did anybody else play Kingdom New Lands, by the way?
No.
No?
No, I heard it's good, though.
Okay. I'll real quick then give it my spiel, because I really, really like it. Kingdom New Lands is the expansion to Kingdom, one of my favorite games from last year, one of my favorite indies from last year. It basically takes the Kingdom formula and expands greatly upon it, adds a few new... elements, and I don't want to spoil too much because it's great fun and you should get it. But so the win condition in Kingdom was effectively like eliminate the enemies, right? And within New Lands, it changes to a sort of progression system to where once you are able to successfully defend your homestead, you move to a new land, weirdly enough, and try to sort of start it all up again and defend that position until you can move on to the next one. So you're moving around this map of the overworld on a boat from island to island and continually trying to build the kingdom up from scratch and defend the new area and until you can find the next place. So it's also made some gameplay changes that I feel are absolutely fantastic. They changed it so your characters can actually run instead of just walking around from point to point. And there's just some minor stuff as well. But bottom line, it's a really solid expansion. It's free if you own Kingdom, by the way. So if you bought the base game, you can get New Lands for free. But I feel like they did such a great job of not trying to, you know, do something to change the way that Kingdom plays. They just built completely from the foundation of what Kingdom is and made it better in every discernible fashion that I can see or describe. So I don't want to spoil too much because I think it's great and I think you should check it out. But it's $15 on Steam. If you don't have the original Kingdom, if you do, it's totally free. It's Kingdom New Lands. It's real good.
YouTube.com/BearTaffy
yeah,
for
if
videos.
You wanna, if you want to see the playthrough of that one, feel free to go there. But yeah, there's my plug for New Lands because I think it's great. And now for everybody's favorite main attraction, it's No Man's Sky. No Man's Sky. It's finally here. Came out on the PS4 earlier this week. It's now available on the PC as of 10 a.m. Pacific time this morning. Boy, oh boy, are they running into some issues, though. Oh, man. We got another Arkham Knight situation on our hands. God damn. Okay, man. Take the floor.
It's awful. I went on a rant on Twitter, really, really hard rant. This is one of the worst ports in a long time. It is fucking awful. First and foremost, if you have a powerful PC, it doesn't matter. And the argument that I don't want to see because it's dumb is that, well, it runs fine on my computer. Good. I'm happy it runs fine on your computer because it doesn't run fine on most computers. Right now, the problem is it's completely unoptimized. Frame dips. It struggles to maintain 60 FPS. There's a lot of stuttering where the screen just stops for a minute and then it'll pick back up and speed back up. The FOV slider has an effect, but it's really minor. Like, you bring it from, I think it starts at 50 or 60, you can bring it all the way up to 100, but it looks really similar. Like, it looks kind of the same. Texture quality in the pop-in is just as bad as the PS4 version. There's no level of detail slider or line of sight slider. Everything kind of does that weird, grainy pop-in, you know what I mean? Like, it phases in this weird, grainy texture.
Shimmers in like sand.
Yeah,
it's a very odd way to describe it, but it does.
It's really, really, I hate it. I know other games have done that in the past that I didn't like it then. I don't like it now. It's just a piss poor port that clearly was rushed in some way or another. And somebody discovered, now it could mean nothing, it could mean everything, we don't know, but there are Sony PS4 files in the PC version of the game, which some people say that indicates that it was a copy-paste port. Other people say it could mean nothing and that people, they reuse code all the time. So we don't know, but that's just kind of icing on the shit cake that we've gotten for No Man's Sky so far. It's really, really bad.
Bear, can you play the clip I sent you?
Oh, God. Can you...
I mean, I feel like that's like in-game, so people can really appreciate how good the procedural generation actually is.
Is that on your channel, Fox?
Yeah. No, it's not on my channel.
I haven't played the game yet, but I put it in the Skype chat, so.
Okay, I'll look there, yeah.
But,
I can't
apparently somebody said
shit.
It's confirmed to mean nothing. That's good, I'm glad to hear it. The port is still, like, ass, but I'm glad. There's other things about it that I fucking hate. Little things that clearly point, like, it was such a console game ported over to PC. The fact that I have to hold E on everything is really weird. The pointer being a giant circle is bizarre.
It's like a virtual reality game, which I don't really get how that happened.
It's so weird. And to get out of menus, I have to right-click a lot. Escape doesn't work. Like, you actually have to just right-click to get out of menus. It's such a fucking weird, weird port that just... It needed so much more time, whatever they did. And now, only now, today, they said they're bringing on a bigger QA team to QA the PC version of the game. I'm like, that needed to be done, like, months ago. That's not a post-release 1.0 full-price $60 game out thing you do. This game feels like it desperately needs to be an early access game. It doesn't feel finished. And there are big features that are just completely missing, and little things that the developers that are doing that are kind of annoying me, like their non-answers to questions that players have, like, can you meet other players, yes or no? And he's just like, ha-ha,
it's kind of like, I'm contractually obligated not to answer this question, so I'll sort of cutely get around it. But he doesn't say that's why.
Who knows? Yeah, that might be the reason.
I feel like there's some assumptions we can safely make here. That this was a game made first and foremost for the PlayStation. And, you know, it's clear in both the design and in the fact that Sony was behind Hello Games from day one and has been the driving force behind making this a $60 title with the amount of hype that it has behind it. That was, like, Sony
too
basically
much hype.
Paid...
No game can live up to the hype this game has.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
This is like this generation's sport.
Yeah.
It really
was really good though.
Well, we haven't even got to how good the game is yet. We're talking about the PC port at the moment. But I it's clear just from like the UI decisions, the way that you interact with things. I think console first was the MO from the beginning. And oh, God, now I've lost my other point. I do want to talk about the fact that I like the game, though, as Fox mentioned. Like, I think that's also noteworthy, but, yeah, it's...
I'd like to maybe step in with my first impressions,
sure.
Because I think there's something kind of telling about how that all went down, because it was very awkward. And keep in mind, I've been the guy saying since this was announced, like, please temper your expectations, because there's no way it was going to live up to any of these thoughts.
Yeah.
That being said, I still think that it should meet some minimum requirements for competency as far as the port goes. So what happened was I turned on the game for the first time. First thing you see is this rushing star system coming at you, which lagged like crazy.
Yeah.
I was like, all right, this is a really bad first thing to see. Then it goes, fades to white, and I'm like, all right, it says, what, press E to initialize or something. So I held down E. Starts talking computer stuff at me for a bit, initializing and looking around in a circle. I'm like, wow, this looks awful. I need to change the options. So I hit escape, go to the options menu, and I changed the resolution, I changed the filtering. All this stuff was set to default to 30 FPS and medium texture settings, which I don't really understand. I think the developer himself said that he doesn't know why it's set to 30 by default. No big deal. Whatever. Yeah. Change the settings. It's part of PC gaming.
Mm-hmm.
I change the settings, says you need to restart for these settings to take effect. All right, that's a pretty common thing as well, not a huge deal. I alt-tab to go ask where the quit button is on Skype, because I figured one of these guys would know. And I find out it has one, but it's in the options menu under extras, and I didn't know where it was. But anyway, after I minimized it, it was stuck in my taskbar, and I couldn't maximize it again. So the only way to fix the problem was to end process. Because you can't alt-tab out of it in full screen. Granted, I was going to change it to borderless window anyway, so not the end of the world. But it does mean that it didn't save my progress through the intro, so I get to watch that again. Second time through, it didn't save all my options, so I had to go back in and change another thing, which required another restart. It's a cycle.
Mm-hmm.
And I had to watch the intro 3 or 4 times before I could actually start playing the game, which is really stupid.
I've had to, on something even more basic than that, the game won't even boot for me unless I hit the play button about 5 or 6 times, and then it'll boot up.
That's usually a Steam issue, isn't it?
I see arguments like, well, give it a few days. Simple things like that should be working day one. And one of the things I hate is like, well, it's an indie game for a small team. Then don't charge AAA prices. You're charging $60 for a game on Steam right now. People expect a basic level of competency in the port. It should work. There shouldn't be hard crashes. I shouldn't have to hit the play button 5 or 6 times. The game should not struggle on a beast computer. It does so many things that just like, yeah. Well, it's a give it a few days, they're gonna fix it. We shit on Ubisoft for broken games. We shoot it on EA for broken games. I'm gonna shit on these guys for charging $60 for a broken game.
The layman,
you don't get a pass.
The layman has no idea this is an indie title, by the way. Like,
right.
To every other gamer in the world, this just looks like another huge Sony title. It's a $60 game that's been on commercials for years. Like, this is the real deal. So they're expecting this from it.
Right.
I think run Fraps for a while too to see what my frame rate was. And in case you don't know. My specs are generally, like, I have a GTX 980 Ti and 16 gigs of RAM. Shouldn't be any problem. I should be able to max everything out. No big deal. And for the most part, it did max everything out. I set the max frame rate to the max setting, which I guess means it's not capped. And I was getting between 90 and 110 FPS, which sounds like it should be perfect. Mm-hmm. But it has micro hitches in it, which mean it's sort of like a delay that's happening separate of the frame rate. So even though it should be smooth, it's still stuttering, because I guess it's just loading in things but not taking into account the frame rate. The other thing I thought that might be is maybe it's having issues because the servers are super overloaded on day one. And I know that sounds like a very strange excuse to make, but if you remember back to the launch of Diablo 3, the frame rate was somewhat tied to the network connection, unfortunately. And I don't know if this is the case, but I just thought maybe it could have something to do with it, because it could also just be the optimization. Probably more likely is that. That was all frustrating. And then the other problem I had was I had my controller plugged in and I didn't realize it, but it hadn't defaulted to keyboard settings, and I was using my keyboard and it said, like, press A to repair, and it meant A on the controller, not A on my keyboard. So A on my keyboard would change my inventory slide to the other, like my ship or my whatever the other one is.
Right.
And even though I understood after a while that that's what was going on, I still didn't realize that, like, Y equaled X and X equals E on the keyboard. Granted, I think I can restart it now with my controller unplugged,
yeah,
and it should actually have the proper...
That's a controller thing for sure, yeah.
Yeah, but it should detect that you're using the keyboard and change the settings dynamically.
All right.
Not everything needs to have the game reset, is what I'm trying to say, including changing resolution.
So I will contend that I did not really have any huge technical issues with my experience in the game thus far. I played about 90 minutes worth, mostly just getting my bearings and figuring out what the hype is all about. I mean, golly jeepers. So I thought it was pretty smooth. I think, Nick, this is something you mentioned. You may have already said this, but the textures do seem a little muddy.
No, I didn't talk about that yet, actually. Oh, okay. But the graphics really didn't look as good as I expected them to.
Yeah, I think I was expecting this going in. I was expecting not to be wowed by, like, the landscapes of the planets, by the individual textures, by just rocks and trees and stuff. I didn't really ever think that there was going to be too much to that. I thought the animals would maybe impress me. So, like, they I've seen a whole bunch of screenshots and stuff. Sort of just looks like sometimes they're just sort of
they look stupid.
Yeah,
Swagosaurus Rex.
Like, they look
they just
stupid
like this
as hell.
Amalgamation of limbs and body parts. So this is just, like, procedurally generated, which is ridiculous.
Go to YouTube and just type in Swagosaurus Rex.
Okay,
It'll pull up the video.
I did want to do that.
Or the giant dinosaur with butterfly wings that just flies. That just makes no... Like, the tiny little butterfly wings. My problem with the procedural generation, this is just an issue with it as it is, as it stands right now, is that these creatures look like spore creatures that you make. And they have, like... They're, like, random bits of animals that come together from whatever algorithm tells them to put these pieces together. And then they're assigned, like, movement A, B, C, or D. And that is just their movement. And it looks so unnatural in the way that they move. Like, they look awkward as hell.
We were talking about that in the Skype, and Ryan was like, oh, come on, right?
No,
but, like, to me... That's like a big part of the game is discovery, like this new sense of, like, you know, wonder, and you're going to these worlds and seeing all these fantastically unique creatures. But, like, it shouldn't be, like, I understand it's a game and procedural is not an easy thing to do, but you shouldn't look at it and be like, oh, come on, like,
right.
Really, it's like that thing looks like...
I do want to preface, like, the technology that they're using to create, like, Yeah, this is Swagosaurus Rex you're looking
That's
at right
so
now.
That's so good.
So funny.
The technology that they're using to do this, whatever the technology that they created or whatever code they wrote, is very impressive.
Like, yeah.
It's cool that they're able to do what they're doing. But much like Mouth said, these animals look so fucking bizarre a lot of the time. You're like, that's like a Play-Doh creature who jumps a lot. Like, that looks dumb as hell.
Oh, man. The way they find Planet Jelly
physically impossible, too. Yeah, like, the way the gut sticks out like that. And
yeah.
Why does he have hooves if he walks on two legs? I don't understand.
It's really... Yeah, again, it's like spore creatures. That's what it looks like. It's like spore creatures that are just generated that you get to explore. It's like being able to first-person explore a spore galaxy. what it is.
Yeah.
The gameplay itself is relatively shallow so far, and I don't think it gets any different than what it is. It's mostly just going from planet to planet, scanning things. It's a relaxing exploration game that, in a weird way, reminds me, I think Nick might have said it a little bit in the chat before, in a weird way of Solus, in that it's all about the exploration and whatever weird story that's going on.
Oh, Solus
but they
Project.
Shoot.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. Yeah, the Solus Project, sorry.
I thought you meant like it's Solus.
The Solus Project. I should have said the whole game name. But in a weird, but they shoehorned in survival elements to be like, hey, gameplay.
Yeah.
But I'm like maybe 2 hours in so far. And I have so much of fuel that I have no, like, worries about surviving. Like, every time my exosuit's like, you're down 50%, I'm like, well, I have, like, 90 backstocks of fuel to keep my life support. You're trading food, sleep, and eating for exosuit maintenance and fuel for your ship. You're doing the same thing.
That bothers me about survival games, too. And it dawned on me, you know, slightly unrelated, but RimWorld, right? You have to sleep and eat and stuff. I was like, there's no bathrooms and there's no showers. Like, I feel like if you're going to kind of go for a survival aspect, you should try to cover off those things. That just seems... Yeah, like, go all in. I mean, you don't have to be relentless where it's very hard to come by resources to actually survive, but, like, I feel like it should be the total package, right? You have to sleep, you have to eat, you have to go to the washroom, you have to manage your ship, stuff like that. You know, don't half bake it.
I want to give my breakdown of what I think the gameplay is comparable, and I don't want you to take this as a condemnation of the whole thing, because I think I still have the potential to enjoy this somewhat, but you should know the bare bones of the gameplay core mechanics. What I would liken it to most is an iterative game, like a Clicker Heroes or something, where they immediately limit your ability to do hardly anything, and the whole point of the game is to become more efficient in your traversal, or more efficient in your ability to get around and find things. So you get extremely limited mobility, jetpack, weapon, ship, inventory. Mm-hmm. All of those things are purposely annoyingly bad. And your whole goal is to go explore and find essentially what would equate to things you click on in one of those clicker games. That will eventually affect your efficiency, so the game becomes more enjoyable and easier to manage all of the bars that are constantly draining. So there's like heat planets, ice planets, toxic planets, varieties of different
things.
They're
all affecting the same bar.
They all affect the same bar, which means there's always a stamina bar going down, there's always some sort of poison bar going down, and there's your health bar, which is often going down as a result of getting hit by stupid things or drones that'll randomly show up. And all of those things that are just there, those bars, those the enemies, they're all just sort of little impedances, little annoying things to keep you from doing the thing you want to do, which is go find the stuff so you can have an easier time playing the game. So that's ultimately the core gameplay kind of panned out to me, like in World of Warcraft, when you're looking for herbs as an herbalist, and the whole landscape is mostly empty, but you want to find a few key things within it, and there's not much else to do. And I find that sort of a tranquil, fun thing to do, in that it's very simple, you can kind of turn your mind off, but there's very little depth to it. Aside from even just looking around, and honestly, since the graphics were a bit muddy and blurry, like even the atmosphere suffered a little bit. There's some cool cinematic kind of like colorful lights that'll happen in caves or kind of mysterious looking stuff, but for the most part it's just like big open MMO looking landscape is what I saw.
It's pretty, there's this other thing, and I don't want to, I'm not trying to come off as coming out to shit on the game. Like, I had pretty low expectations going into this game to begin with. I was not really on the No Man's Sky hype train. I'm still walking away a little disappointed with it so far. You're right in that there's no depth. First of all, the UI is like a fucking mess. Like, it's very difficult to parse what's happening with the UI. But there's other things that kind of bother me, too. Like, when you're flying your ship on the planet, the game doesn't allow your ship to go below a certain depth. There's an invisible wall that you will hit that you cannot go below when you're exploring the planet. So you can't fly your ship into these great chasms and, like, check out these cool things or, like, fly them near mountains. The game won't let you get that low in your ship. And if you're beelining it to try and crash into a mountain, the game automatically moves your ship up and over or around. So you can't... They're taking away this weird freedom that bothers me that they're taking away because I want to be able to maybe fly close to a mountain or fly close to a tree and get these up-close and personal looks. And the only way to get down is to land, and then the landing process is just automated. It's like, you're on the ground. Okay, now you can walk around. So taking that away takes away another layer of depth or exploration that I would love to have. I'd love to be able to fly my ship low to the ground and kind of like zoom around and check things out. But they don't let you. They don't. The game just is an invisible wall that you hit that you can't go down.
So
it sucks.
I've been listening and not doing a lot of talking because I haven't even played No Man's Sky yet. I'm still waiting for like opinions and hearing what people think about it. But from what I've heard so far, like, you know, this is just maybe not, you don't mean it this way, but this is what I hear. Like, it sounds like you would never, like, this game sounds awful. It sounds like, no, okay, I've heard nothing good about it.
Let me jump in here then.
Before we continue, there's an echo coming from somewhere that's bothering chat. Somebody has an echo.
Yeah, I turned myself down. I don't know where it's coming from.
Let me mute my mic.
That's weird. I should be hearing it if chat is hearing it.
So I don't know where it's coming from. I'm not hearing it either, but.
Sorry, chat. I got no idea.
I don't hear it either.
Okay. Anyway. I think some chatters are going crazy right now. I like it. I actually am like I'm enjoying my time. So like for the first hour or so, I was a little put off by just how much of an impedance it is to actually get the resources necessary to use your ship. So that took like quite a while to just wander around my starting planet and find all the shit I needed. But once I got into my ship, I really enjoyed the sense of scale that was like immediately present as soon as you break the atmosphere of the first planet. Like, it's phenomenal. This is by far, I think, the best part of the game is the sense of scale that they create for you, because it, like, the way that they sold it with the 5 quintillion planets and like you'll have to fly for hours just to get from point A to point B, like, that's real. They completely delivered on that, because that is 100% in the game. That like, functionally, that is everything they wanted it to be. But it's like the depth when you get to somewhere that the game begins to become a little bit less interesting. You know, like there's very little to actually do in the game, you know, and that I think that's going to be the problem that most people have with it, is that there's very little by way of objective or, you know, classic gameplay that is probably going to turn a lot of people off to it.
Mal, yes. Mm-hmm.
Would you like to address the class, Mal?
Yes. Have any of you played Kerbal Space Program before?
Yes.
A little bit.
That's obviously, they're not the same game, but I feel like if you're looking for a game that you really want to feel a sense of accomplishment, I guess, that is good. It's hard as shit, but you build your ship and you travel into space and you land on, you know, there's only a dozen planets system, right? Total, mm-hmm. or something, but like, you actually kind of have to be a NASA scientist, like, to know these orbits and to build the ships appropriately and land. Like, that's really cool. I think this is more for people that just, like, want to drive on a highway, you know? Yeah. Just put the windows down, kind of just chill.
It's a walking simulator with cool procedural generation exploration with really neat atmosphere and space traveling mechanics. I'm with you there. I just have a hard time swallowing, and I know this is all subjective, but that this game is worth $60. I don't know. Like, it doesn't feel like, if people have to make a $60 decision on this game and pull the trigger on it, I don't, unless you're super looking for a very shallow, kind of relaxing exploration experience, I don't know if this is going to be the game you want to pull the trigger for $60 for. $60 is really high.
I think it's important
to note. That is a AAA pricing.
I think it's important to note that with a game like this, maybe we're not getting the full experience with like 2 or 3 hours. You know, I think there's a safe assumption to be made there that there's probably a lot more game to be played. And perhaps it does get a lot more involved and intricate later on down the road. Like maybe 12, 15 hours in, you're starting to really get involved with more gameplay. But that's yet to
be
determined.
How do you anticipate there would be more, though? Because I feel like we've kind of seen the whole gameplay loop within one planet.
That's
from what people have said on PS4, this is what you get. Like, people who have been playing 20, 30 hours, like, this is the core gameplay loop. You land on a planet, you scan things, you explore, you gather fuel, you leave, you go to a planet, you scan things, you get fuel, and you just keep making your way to the center of the galaxy.
I don't think there's more.
Well, you get to name the planets, though, too, right? They said
you'll never see again and no one else will ever see.
That's the other thing, too. There's no attachment to any of the things that you do because this is one planet and 18 quintillion planets. Everything you do on this planet is meaningless. You're like, I named this species I discovered. I named this planet I discovered. No one's going to see it. I'll never see it again. See you later.
Not to mention that the ultimate objective is to get to the center of the universe. So really, like, it's inherently implying that you're going to leave that all behind and never come back to it again. Galaxy, not the universe, yeah.
Technically, every point in the universe is the center of the universe because it's ever expanding.
Don't blow my mind right now. I'm not high enough.
Sorry. In that kind of podcast, dude. Come on.
I can't handle it anymore.
We are the universe observing itself.
I'm curious because, like, you know, we talk about this gameplay loop like it's impossible to be, like, a good thing, but I'm okay with this kind of loop.
Yeah.
Because, you know, a lot of games have it. You know, it's used as a tool. It's not there for no reason because you do it as a way to find things or just continue the game. Like, if there's something that I can find or do anywhere in the game that, you know, finding these things will help me get closer to or get me faster there. Like, if there's some planet with some crazy, like, rare mineral or something, I'm just, you know, throwing things out there, some rare creature or just some secret or what have you, something like that, then I'm willing to do those boring things to increase my chances of finding something like that because that's exciting to me. But if there's nothing on the other end of this loop, this chain, then why even go across it? Why experience it?
So the most interesting parts of the game for me have been, you know, outside of the gameplay loop, have been when I found space stations and I'm interacting with aliens there. There is, like, the entire language learning aspect of it. So you're going around to find monoliths or different landmarks that you can interact with in order to gain knowledge or access new technologies or learn languages, you know, stuff like that. And that, I think, is, you know, outside of the loop, what is going to draw people to? That's the additional factor that I think you're looking for there, because there's an air of mysteriousness to it, and it's cool to just happen upon those things too. You know, like, not to necessarily be on a mission that says go look up 5 new alien words on the runes of Maharkabarth or something like that. You know, it's like, you go do whatever the fuck you want, and if it happens to be that you land on this place and you come across this area, then you will learn this information. And that is, you know, like, that's essentially what I think is the draw. That is alone gonna be enough for some people to where, like, I can just float around in space willy-nilly, like, just decide this planet's where I want to go, and hopefully there's something cool there.
Right.
Thing is, I can do that in Elite Dangerous and have more fun with it.
Yeah.
Star Citizen isn't a complete product.
You okay there, buddy?
Well, no.
But, like, that, I will say No Man's Sky has made me take out my SciTech, which is my joystick, and want to play Elite Dangerous again and play the Explorer and go out into the universe and explore these things. And I think the mechanics of Elite Dangerous, because there's, like, a budget behind it bigger than what they've had, you know, it's better. I just, man, it, for me, with the gameplay, it really keeps going back to, like, wow, they're actually, like, charging AAA pricing for this game, and I just don't see it.
I think that's a really big deal. But people are always like, you know, $60, is that really that much more than $40 or $30?
For a lot of people,
but
it is, yeah.
It really is. Mm-hmm. Like, as for me right now, if this game was $30, I probably would have pre-ordered it already. There was enough there for me to go, all right, $30, I'm going to get something from that probably, even if the game's not what I expect. $60, though, like, my brain just, it flips around. It's like, I don't want to buy this game yet. I want to wait and I want to see what's it about. That extra money just instantly changes my perspective, like, on the game. Even though it's only $30 difference, it's enough for me to want to hold back and wait and just see what if the game is going to be worth it or not.
Mm-hmm.
I really don't have any gripe with the $60 price tag. My only gripe is that the port was just so badly done. Oh,
that's the worst part.
Yeah.
Like, the port is awful.
If this was smooth sailing and the game kind of just was intuitive and made sense, like all the stuff I complained about didn't seem to be there, I mostly wouldn't have that much to complain about. I just think this is a much more niche game than anybody gave it credit for because it doesn't have nearly any depth. And for some people, that's fine. I might be okay with that. Personally, I like walking around sort of empty environments and looking for stuff, but I grant most people don't.
That's why I said like it's a subjective thing. Like the price tag is definitely person to person.
Given the technology, though, it's a pretty cool idea, and I think I'm okay with supporting that idea because it's something different. But also, it's kind of not that great either. I don't know. It's a really mixed bag. I'm just going to have to play more of it, see what I think after 10 hours.
I think I'm in a similar boat. I don't take any issue with the price, but I like it, honestly. Like I'm actually like really enjoying myself. I'm excited to play more of it. So I think I may be an anomaly in both that and the fact that I had like virtually no technical issues either, which I guess is abnormal.
I think I've heard enough to give it a shot at this point.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, I'm sure we'll talk about it again.
Did you play any, Malph? Have you played it?
No, well, it's $66.49 in Canada, so I mean, like, I don't know. I've honestly been thinking about it because I've always, just in general, I enjoy space and science and technology, and I'm actually getting ready to reinstall Star Citizen because I have a newer graphics card that can handle that. But
finally hit 30 FPS.
I was playing Overwatch at 110 in 4K.
Oh shit!
Oh yeah! Oh yeah!
Oh yeah, bud!
I think I'm gonna. I want to play it, but I'm definitely gonna wait a bit. I have no real like. I can't wait about this sort of game. But just my general feelings are is, you know, they kind of with the scope of it, I feel for an indie studio, they bit off more than they can chew. You know, I always seem to go on this idea, like anybody can have great ideas and big scopes for games, but you as a developer, you as a person, no matter what you're doing, you have to understand kind of where your boundaries are, your limits and stuff. And obviously you push your boundaries, but baby steps, you know, they're making this crazy procedural 15 quintillion.
Joe Danger to this.
Pardon?
They went from Joe Danger to this. Joe Danger was the last game.
And, basic arcadey runner.
I don't know. I think it's better left up to, you know, people that have, you know, Chris Roberts with Star Citizen, right? He's been making space simulation games for like what, 2 decades now or something. So like, that's kind of if they said he was making this, I'd be like, okay, like I'm actually definitely gonna pay attention to this. When you go from Joe Danger to this, I'm like. You know, I admire that they're trying to expand their portfolio, but I don't know. It's like I've always had this idea of my dream game. If I could have an unlimited budget and make a game, it would basically be an Earth simulation in that, you know, this is the Fable I wanted, right? When it rained, the water would actually move and, like, it could cause landslides and shit. Like, all the systems would be in the game, right? Obviously, I couldn't just go out and make that because simulating a planet is, we can't do that right now with supercomputers, right? So I kind of feel like that's a similar analog to this. They spent all this time trying to get this procedural stuff going, and it kind of
works. Wait, we need a game on this.
But yeah, it's more to me, it's like a framework or a techie kind of demo, a proof of concept,
tree for procedural universes. They made an engine to make other technology within.
Yeah,
it should be used as a building block, not so much as the thing itself.
They shouldn't have sold it as a game. They should have been like Unreal Engine 4. You've got Unity. You've got come up with a snazzy name or something, and then people could start building sweet ass space simulation games on it. Because everybody in the rum is making those now, so why not have
why not have a framework for it?
An engine. Oh, Total Biscuits in chat, by the way.
Oh, hey, TB. Yeah, I know he's been having his issues with it today too, huh?
Well, in chat, he's like, hey, it's also a boring as fuck game.
Yeah. I'm sure we'll talk about it more in the coming weeks. But yeah, I'm sure there's a patch impending as well. $60.
I'm excited to see where we are next week.
Yeah, me too.
Where we all
me
stand.
Too. Mm-hmm.
What do you think it would have been like if we didn't get that week delay for the PC patch?
Oh man.
Oh yeah, geez.
Oh goodness.
Or they added the ability to feed animals.
We can already feed animals, man.
That's what they added in the week is one of the things.
Let me take some seeds from a tree on one planet, some acorns, go to another planet and plant them and see if they'll grow.
Peter Molyneux, cool out, man. Just go back to Godus Wars, all right? The greatest god game to never exist.
$60. It's available now on PS4 and PC. It's No Man's Sky. Cool. All right, well, that's going to bring us into everybody's favorite segment. It's Ask Roundtable.
Woo.
Yeah. Ask Roundtable is a weekly segment where you send your questions into roundtableyt@gmail.com. We're going to do our best to answer them. This week's question comes from Jake. Jake wants to know.
Jake from State Farm.
How do you each feel about the way games age in terms of art design and implementation? Are there many games that you think hold up well due to the timeless or interesting art style? And if so, what are these games?
I have a good one.
Please.
I think a good comparison.
Please.
Two games, very similar release date, The Legend of Zelda, Twilight Princess, The Legend of Zelda, Wind Waker. And I have a huge bias towards Twilight Princess. I like the game way more, but I will totally admit that Wind Waker is a game that will look good for the rest of time, whereas Twilight Princess already does not look nearly as good as it did when it first came out. You have one game that just, you know, went with the generic Zelda style, was like, you know, this is like Ocarina of Time. It's just, we're going to make it look, it's going to be there. That's the art style.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll roll with it. But, you know, when they made Wind Waker, they said, all right, let's try something different. Let's put effort into how this game looks. Let's put design and thought and all that into it. And it showed. The game looks incredible. You don't even have to look at the HD remake. The HD remake doesn't even need to exist of Wind Waker. The original game, still to this day, plug in your GameCube, turn it on, it will look beautiful, just as it did when it first came out. That is the kind of thing that makes a game last forever in terms of art, is that kind of focus and design.
I think the first thing I ever think of when I hear questions like this is Okami, the 2006 PS2 game that featured the white dog. I think we all know it, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
But that one, it seems like that art style was just so unique, especially for the time. It stood out above everything. Like, nothing looked like Okami back in the day. And I think even now, it's still more beautiful than a lot of the games we're getting this year, honestly. That was a goddamn phenomenal game.
I kind of put, for me, is generally, but you can kind of lump them into two categories. Like, there are games that tend to try and push the boundaries of kind of getting closer and closer to photorealism.
Mm-hmm.
The current games and that, you're like, oh, they look really good for now, but in 20 years, we'll actually have, you know, photorealistic stuff. So the further you go back in that vein of game history, you know, oh, Quake, you're not going to believe how good this looks, you know, when they release that stuff. And obviously now you look at it, it's like, eh. And then you've got other games that kind of follow a more a different art style. More recent examples, maybe like Firewatch or The Long Dark, right? They kind of like, Long Dark has this sort of almost like weird construction papery sort of aesthetic to it, and it's simple and it looks really nice. And Firewatch as well has that, and along with The Witness, right? That sort of clay sort of weird texture, smooth,
yeah,
just nice to look at.
How would you describe that? Yeah, it's a particular style.
I when I look at it, I feel like it's, you know, like the clay, I could bite into it, and it's like, it's, I don't know.
Yeah.
It's a very tactile way that the light interacts with it. Mm-hmm. It really emphasizes textural elements in a way that really works well for that color palette.
Mm-hmm. And, I mean, obviously it's very beautiful now, and I think that's something that's really going to age well, you can tell. And like we mentioned before, kind of pixel-related games,
things,
right?
Like Super Mario Brothers, they're never going to age because of their design and art style.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I think the less you focus on realism, and then the more you kind of pick a style and stick to it,
right?
You're gonna
early PC games have not aged well at all. It was one of the things, self plug, when I was doing the System Shock 2 review for Judge Mathis. One of the things that I talked about there is just like how all those early 2000s, late 90s games have all aged horribly. They just look awful. But when you look at a game that picks a style or pick like even cel shading stuff in that like, PS2 era, that stuff, I don't want to say it's timeless because we don't know what it's going to look like 20 years from now as far as like comparatively, but I'm almost willing to say it's going to that is going to look good regardless of how old it's going to be.
Probably true.
I think it was a bit of a curve with it, right? So we started out in an era where there was very limited usage with what you could do for color palettes and just creativity as far as art design goes in games. And they all sort of found their own voice in that because they really didn't have an option to chase after naturalism. Once you started to enter like the mid to late 90s, people started to get this idea like, well, maybe photorealism is something we should shoot for. And they went after whatever techniques in hardware at the moment were the most exciting things. And they sort of built games around art styles that weren't really styles. They were more just catering to what makes the game look the most naturalistic at the time. Obviously, those things age because we have a moving perspective on what looks naturalistic as we get improved hardware. As we got closer to current, and I believe this is also still a sliding thing, we start to see things that look a little bit more well, actually close to naturalism, but we don't know yet where our perspective is going to take us in 10 more years. That's why stuff like The Witness is dead on what I want to see for games that look good, quote-unquote. And just in general, I think 2D games are much more likely to have a unified art style than 3D games are. As soon as you start introducing various levels of lighting and things that don't quite mesh properly, you get repeated tiling textures and things just start to look off really quickly. I mean, do I need to bring up Dark Souls 2? Probably not.
Probably not.
But yeah, as we get closer to current, that is going to keep shifting along with us to what we think is currently good looking. Mm-hmm. But the old stuff generally holds up because they didn't have a lot of options for creativity and they made the best of it.
That's a fucking fantastic answer, man. God damn.
I'm not surprised they get the best answer for this.
Honestly, no, Fox said what I was getting ready to say before I said it. He was on to.
Yeah.
But I think there's one more thing I have to add too, is that, you know, you can have these really good looking games and stuff, and there are many games like that, but I think the realism and just the movement, I guess the animations and the interaction with the environment, that has a big impact on how I perceive a game as, you know, being photorealistic. It's more of just like, I guess, transitioning to realistic in general, right? You look at somebody, they're walking on a pathway or they're walking upstairs. If it looks like their feet are kind of floating and stuff, doesn't matter how good it looks, that'll just
yank you right out of it, right?
That'll pull you right out of it. So,
right out of
like
it with that Swagosaurus Rex.
Yeah, I'm so glad we looked that up.
Yeah, I can't wait for the day when there is no more, there's a plane along the stairs and the character floats up the plane. Yeah. I really want to see Collision be mapped with the accuracy that they started to do with Assassin's Creed, where every surface seems to have an actual collision plane that maps what you actually see instead of an invisible bounding box.
Some games do that. Not a lot.
Some games do it, but it hasn't become the de facto answer for 3D models, and I want it to never not be that.
I've always...
like, there's a lot of little granular details that have not happened yet and need to happen in the future.
I've always been weirdly obsessive about that in particular, whether or not characters actually walk up steps the way that human beings do. Yeah. And
so it's awesome when they do.
Yeah, it's so satisfying, right? Well,
yeah. It's a shitty shortcut they think people don't realize is happening, but more often than not, I think people notice it.
I just want to see, like, when you watch somebody who's walking, you know, they have the walking animation of the legs backward and forward, and then all of a sudden you just move the analog stick a little bit, so they're moving very slowly, so you can kind of just see, like, the leg does that weird, like, it's doing the full animation, but it's just, like, slowing it down, so it looks incredibly unnatural.
The Uncharted games have done the best job with, like, realistic animations. They're always gorgeous to look at and watch.
You can't map the analog stick, so the further, or the closer to zero the directionality is, the slower the animation goes. People don't just walk on a sliding scale of the same motion in all of those gestures.
Speak for yourself, man.
Yeah. Well, all right, I don't. So, again, that's another one of those shortcuts that is just like, well, you could min-max all of these animations and spend 25 years making your game, or you could, like, do some things that people probably won't care about and get it out. When and, you... most people just don't have the time or money to do that kind of stuff, but I hope it changes someday with middleware.
Mm-hmm. Hell yeah. Well, thank you, Jake, for the question. Appreciate it. If you got a question that you'd like answered, yeah, that was a good one. Send it over to roundtableyt@gmail.com. We would love to get more of those. In fact, we beg of you. Let's get some more. roundtableyt@gmail.com. Thank you very much for those. And it's time for everybody's favorite segment after their favorite segment. It's Nick's Weird Games.
It's time for that.
And with no Ryan here, unfortunately, no theme song tonight, so I suppose we'll just jump right into it. Unless Malph has something prepared for us.
Oh God!
put him on the spot.
You're in that slot right there.
I'm good at coming up with the songs. Like that's what I like to do. Uh-huh. But Ryan is on a different level in his ability.
He is the rap god.
Yeah. So I don't want to ruin it's
okay.
his thing.
Okay, that's fair. Right. I won't put that pressure.
Right. I just am rap god in chat.
Yeah, that'll do.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Chat is hidden. I'm ready to go.
Everybody ready?
Ryan is at the Portland Grand Prix. By the way, I think I failed to mention that at the top of the show, but. There you go.
He's probably singing a song right now. He knows. Mm-hmm. He just like, oh, guys.
Didn't he get knocked out? Didn't he get knocked out in like 15 minutes?
Oh, did he? Oh, no. I haven't been following his progress. Oh,
disaster.
He lost to like an RNG deck. I thought that was great.
Typical.
Poor guy. Okay, what do we got?
All right, I've got a new unprecedented platform for you here on Nick's Weird Games today. We're going to be looking into a GameCube game. Yes, we've never done a GameCube game.
I was hoping for like iOS or something here, but okay.
This is my jam right here. Let's
I could do
it.
That too, but chances are
I don't know
if I would hardly know any iOS games, to be honest. All right, so today we're dealing with a horror first-person action adventure.
Horror first-person action adventure.
Okay. On the GameCube. We've already limited the selection quite a bit.
Exclusively to the GameCube in 2005.
Geist?
Done.
Wow. Hey, man, nice!
Jesus.
Oh, God!
Jesus.
Yeah!
Woo! We missed you those couple of weeks you weren't here, man. That's
just
that's
one
great.
Shot.
Well done. Good work.
Shit.
Geist.
Tell me
more about Geist, though, real quick. I haven't actually heard of this one.
So the premise was that you could snatch the bodies of people that you wanted to accomplish tasks with. So you'd have to sneak around facilities and steal people's bodies and like access labs that only you have the proper ability to. So you're basically like a ghost that can steal bodies.
Hmm.
And it's a first-person shooter. You know, I haven't heard of a lot of people ever playing this, so I thought it might be a good game for the show. Turns out Matt is
too. Like, I got excited about that game, and then the game came out, and everybody's like, it's mediocre. I was like, no. Then I never bought it.
Cool premise, but relegated to GameStop shelf stalkery, I suppose.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody in chat get it here?
Anybody get it as quick as that? Yeah, Jesus.
I saw one before the Vax fan.
The breaded one has gotten it.
Nice.
So congrats, you're the first person.
Congratulations, the breaded one.
You did it.
Well done. Cool.
That was a tough one.
That was a good one. All right, thank you very much for watching this episode of Roundtable Live. We hope you enjoyed it. You can catch this show live here every Friday at 3 p.m. Pacific, 6 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Feel free to follow this channel to be notified when that goes live. If you missed any part of the show, you can find the VOD over on all of our YouTube channels. That's youtube.com/RockLeeSmile, Mathis Games, and Bear Taffy. That's not the URL, but you get it. Twitter.com/RoundtablePC is where you want to go to follow us on Twitter. RoundtablePC or RoundtablePodcast.reddit.com. For the post-show discussion. You can also rate the show 5 stars on iTunes. Really appreciate that. Also want to thank our patrons over on patreon.com/roundtable for supporting the show. The $20 and above patrons we want to thank today include Logan Ray, Samurfet, Super Monoman, Justin, Mediocrities, Myth Scarab, Positron, Brizzle Brip, Christopher Flagg, Eric Schooley, Mavier, Oren Saltzman, David Schmitz, Greenlight, Nerdy Is Fly, Artsy Fartsy, Scrotty119, Matt, Jonathan Graham, General Crunk, and Julian Avelsgard. Thank you guys so much for continuing your support over there on patreon.com/roundtable. We really appreciate that. And we are done. We're going to see you next week. Thank you for watching. Yay. And we'll see you next time.
See you,
everybody.
Bye.
Bye, my shirt.
Fuck Mathis.